I want to start by discussing a couple of the broader factors likely to be important for the horticultural industries in the coming years. Firstly, we have new trade agreements with Asian countries that offer opportunities for Australian agricultural exporters. Trade agreements with Korea and Japan are now in place, and one with China is expected to come into force later this year. Incomes in Asian countries are rising and patterns of demand are changing. ABARES has done some detailed analysis of future demand for food in China, in India and Indonesia, looking way ahead to the year 2050. These studies forecast strong growth in imports of fruit and vegetables to Asian countries over the period to 2050. Thirdly, the Australian dollar has weakened in the past 2 years. This should increase the competitiveness of Australian exporters and alleviate some of the pressure on processors. ABARES assumes the dollar will remain around 76 cents to the US dollar over the next 5 years. That's 17% lower than it averaged last year. And fourthly, water storage in the Murray-Darling Basin is a bit under 50% of capacity. I think it was down to 45 or 46% the last time I looked. This is, in fact, the lowest level in 4 years, but it's well above where it was in the mid-2000s. At these levels, water availability, while not all that good, will probably not constrain production in the short term. Horticulture is one of Australia's major agricultural industries. The gross value of Australia's horticulture industries has fluctuated around $9.5 billion in real terms in the past few years. This is close to 20% of the total value of Australia's farm production. Vegetables on the one hand and fruit and nuts on the other are each worth a little under $4 billion a year. The gross value of horticultural production is projected to increase slowly over the next 5 years, with most of the increase in production being absorbed by the domestic market. Fruit production last year amounted to around $3.5 billion, a bit more than a third of total horticulture. Oranges, bananas and apples are Australia's major fruits by value of production. We expect orange production to increase this season and to continue to increase by around 2% a year in the medium term. This increase is driven partly by expected growth in exports of oranges. Around one third of Australia's oranges are exported. Apples and bananas are produced almost exclusively for the domestic market, and growth of these fruits is expected to be slow, in line with domestic requirements. In total, we expect the gross value of Australia's fruit and nut production, and excluding wine grapes, to increase from $4.1 billion in the current year to around $4.4 billion in real terms in 5 years' time. Production of tree nuts has grown markedly in recent years, driven largely by almonds. But plantings from the mid-2000s are coming to maturity, and tree nut production is forecast to stabilise over the medium term. Production 5 years from now is expected to be only 5% more than in the current year. Now, looking at vegetables, potatoes and tomatoes are the major vegetables produced by total value of production. They account for 30% of the total value of vegetable production. Both potatoes and tomatoes are produced partly for the fresh market and partly for processing, and in both cases, processors have come under pressure from imports. The weakening of the Australian dollar has helped processors, but processors and exporters will continue to be under pressure from low-cost countries. Overall, the total value of vegetable production is forecast to continue to expand slowly in line with the domestic market, from around $4 billion this year to $4.3 billion in 5 years' time. Now, I'd like to look at exports. Australia exported around $1.9 billion worth of horticultural produce last year. The major markets for our fruit, nuts and vegetables were Hong Kong, New Zealand, India and Japan. Around 60% of exports by value were fresh product, the remaining 40% were processed. We import more than we export. The value of imports of horticultural products amounted to about 40% more than the value of exports. But we'll come back to that in a moment. It's useful to look at what is happening with fresh trade separately from trade in processed products. The trends are quite different. Exports of fruit, nuts and fresh fruit, nuts and vegetables were worth around $930 million last year, roughly half the total value of exports. Grapes, citrus, almonds, carrots and cherries are our major fresh horticultural exports. Now, still looking at fresh produce, we export considerably more than we import. In fact, exports of fresh fruit, nuts and vegetables have grown in the past 3 years, and the positive trade balance between exports and imports has widened. On the import side, avocados, grapes, carrots, and kiwi fruit were Australia's major fresh fruit and vegetable imports last year. The United States is the largest exporter of fresh fruit and vegetables to Australia. Counter-seasonal trade in fresh produce is important. This is the pattern of exporting some fresh products, mainly to the Northern Hemisphere countries in our producing season, and importing the same product back from the Northern Hemisphere in our off-season. Here we see the monthly pattern of imports and exports of oranges. Consumers increasingly want to eat fresh fruit all year round. Fresh products can be supplied only by importing fruit during the non-producing months. Consumers in the Northern Hemisphere also want fresh fruit out of season, and this presents opportunities for Australian exporters. But now, if we look at trade in processed products, the picture for exporters has not been as rosy as it has been for fresh produce. Australian fruit and vegetable processors have found it difficult to compete with overseas processors. Imports of processed products have grown, while exports, by and large, have contracted. Our exports of processed products amounted to a third or less the value of imports in the last few years. But the decline in the value of the Australian dollar has, overall, improved the competitiveness of Australian processors. Last year, exports of processed horticultural products increased by 40%, and imports show signs of stabilising. We assume the dollar will stay flat over the medium term, and this may allow some further improvement in the balance of trade for processed products. Now, I want to finish with a look at the total picture of exports, fresh and processed together. Looking at fruit and vegetable exports, we see fluctuation but little increase over the past decade. There was a period of strong growth in nut exports, but that expansion is now over, and there's little potential for further growth in the next few years. Some new export opportunities may be found, particularly in fresh products, to growing markets in Asia. The new trade agreements with Japan, Korea, and China should provide opportunities for horticultural exports. Some tariffs have already been eliminated, including those on cherries, almonds, and dried grapes to Korea. In Japan, also, some tariffs have been eliminated, and the 16% tariffs on oranges will be removed over a 10-year period. In the case of China, nuts and table grapes will be tariff-free 4 years after the agreement comes into effect, and citrus will be tariff-free after 8 years. Overall, we expect the real value of horticultural exports to increase slowly, averaging perhaps 1% a year over the next 5 years to reach $2 billion at the end of the projection period. So in summary, we see modest growth in the production of fruit, vegetables and nuts. Processors are likely to continue to struggle to compete with other countries despite the advantage of the weaker dollar. The gap between exports and imports of processed horticultural produce is likely to remain large, although it could contract a little. Fruit and vegetable producers will continue to depend largely on the domestic market. Exports overall are expected to strengthen a little, boosted by the weaker Australian dollar and by trade opportunities in Asia. Thank you very much.